is found when there is people there. So my question is, and this is true for every value that the government seeks to develop, it is therefore very troubling when a society such as Kenya places the highest value in becoming a politician. A person wishes to become a doctor, right? An engineer, a teacher, a computer scientist, all those. And only means, and his only means ends at the political end. Because then we have a society that only develops non-existent values. For example, one that builds hospitals which have doctors not to be found. And the, personally, I know you have exposed many projects such as that. And this kind of society is dead, is a dead society. I wish to believe that it's a dead society because we have just seen how Kenya is going forth. It has no culture other than glorification of these politicians, how we worship these politicians. We see this in Kenya already, how people worship politicians when they go to our rural areas, when they go to urban areas. You know, this is to say values are created outside of government, not from within it. Change being by default, the overall inexistent value system of a society. And cannot be expected to occur from within the government, right? It occurs without it and is only finally expressed within the government. So my question will be, Morara, if you need to be you need to be in government to bring about change. And we have already seen that the government doesn't bring change. What value system do you have for the country? How are you intending to change this narrative of how government can, how we can change the system when you have, maybe you want to go for a position or anything, since you have declared you want a political party?
Okay, so your question is quite lengthy. Of course, you've taken time to explain in the background of your question. But how I understand it is you are asking, how exactly do we intend to create the values that we seek in governance? Is that, did I hear you correctly? Is that the question?
Precisely.
Yes. So now, let me first give also a little background on that. Now, in Kenya, we have a problem. And that problem is not just in government. That problem is also with the population. In fact, the day before yesterday, I was in a meeting with the Rotaract Club of Ongata Rongai, and I spoke about bad citizens producing bad leaders. That the bad leaders that we see is a product of either lazy citizenship or idle citizenship or unparticipative citizenship. That we have a citizenry that has allowed, that has literally permitted government or other government officials to be corrupt, to be inept, to be incompetent, and then they celebrate them. And I gave examples of people like Anne Waiguru, who was corrupt at NYS and still managed to get the mandate of the people, not once, but twice as a governor. I spoke about Gladys Beausoleil, who is now an MP after doing corruption in the judiciary. I spoke about this guy from my home who used to be, who is now an MP, who was also running away from a corruption scandal, and many others. And it starts giving the vibe, or rather the feeling that we celebrate mediocrity, or that we reward theft. Now, those values, as you've said, they are created from within the society, but you know they are created by individuals. The value system of society is created by the individuals in that society. You cannot ignore the role that eminent personalities or eminent individuals play in terms of creating value systems within the society. I'll give you an example. This is Nelson Mandela. He managed to create a value system in a whole society, to inspire a whole society to reject a certain value system and install a different value system. This is Mwalimu Julius Nyerere, who managed to also inspire a whole society. This is Thomas Sankara, so Martin Luther King Jr., Mahatma Gandhi. There are many, many leaders in history who have been eminent personalities, and they were able to create a certain value system in the society. Now, let me speak about eminent personalities. As you've correctly pointed out, in Kenya, there is a worship of politicians. There is a worship of politicians in the sense that we give them a demigod status. And it is not just politicians, by the way. If I was to remind you, in Kenya, we don't just worship politicians. People also worship pastors. For example, if today Raila leaves ODM, everybody will move out of ODM because they were not there because they believe in the constitution of ODM. They are not there because they believe in the value system of ODM. They are there to bask in the sunlight of the influence of Raila. If Ruto leaves UDA and goes to a different party, everybody leaves, including Ndindi Nyoro, who will close the door. Because they are not there because they believe in UDA. In fact, half the people who are in UDA don't even know that it means United Democratic Alliance. They don't even know the full acronym, the full name of the party. They just know it as UDA. So it means then that we don't have loyalty to systems. We don't have loyalty to institutions, but rather we have loyalty to personalities. The Supreme Court is now as good as who is the Chief Justice, rather than it being a going concern. The same is happening with churches. The people who follow preachers, let me give an example of Prophet Owuor. Some of the people go to Prophet Owuor's church, they don't even know that it's called King's Outreach Ministries. Some of them don't know the full name, they just know the prophet. And if the prophet were to abandon that church, there are so many people that will also leave that church because they were there for that personality. This is our lived reality. Can I change it within 3 years between now and 2027? The answer is no. This is not something I can change in 3 years. And usually I want to be realistic, I want to focus on the things I can change rather than the things that I cannot change. So what then do I do? What I do is, why don't we then, if Kenyans are so loyal to personalities, why don't we create personalities who represent the value systems that we are seeking? Why don't we raise from the ashes leaders who stand for accountability, stand for integrity, stand for good governance, stand for justice, stand for redemption of our economy? Why don't we now raise those kind of personalities? Not worship them, but rather give them a platform and give them a high status so that they can market, or rather brand, the new values that we want. It's the same way we use Kipchoge Keino. Kipchoge Keino is now a brand, and then he is used in the Isuzu D-Max Kipchoge Keino version. He's even used to brand Kenya abroad so that people can see Kenya as a destination because they know him from running, and then they can hear about Kenya from him. So then there's a role to be played by eminent personalities, and that's why I keep saying that Morara was not as popular as I am now. Right now, I am popular. The question is, what am I doing with that popularity? Well, some people on Twitter see that popularity as a problem, but personally, I see it as a solution. Some people think, well, this person is going to be so popular and then is going to bring us all down by betraying us. But I don't look at it that way. I look at it as, this person has so much popularity that we can actually use this popularity to now brand the kind of values that we want. Because when Morara Kebaso becomes popular, it is not me who has made myself popular. It is the people that have made me popular. And they've made me popular so that I can have a bigger platform. Like, they've lifted me to a higher status than them. Ni kama watu kusimama chini wakupe ngazi we upande juu, uende waletee chenye iko juu. So when people give you that platform, I believe I'm supposed to use that platform, number one, as a convener of bringing people together to share ideas. Number two, as a leader to lead the change, not just talk about change, not just complain about how bad things are, but at least make an effort to try and rectify how things are. So that is how I look at the value system. I believe that eminent personalities, or rather people having big brands, can actually help inspire the society towards creating value systems and therefore translate into good governance. I also believe that if we have a president with values, Kenya will have values, because there is a lot that comes from a leader. There is a lot of inspiration that comes from a leader. If you look at families where there is no leadership, yeah, most of the children are wayward, wengine wanakunywa bangi, wengine nitakosa kupigiwa kura na watu wanakunywa bangi, wengine wana some use cocaine, some are drug addicts, others have become gay or homosexuals. And the reason those people have become that way is also because there's a lack of leadership. There's a lack of inspiration from the top. So I believe that leadership is good. And I also believe that the people in government, not government itself, as you correctly pointed out, government doesn't create values. It works with the values it has found. But the people in government, they are there by virtue of politics. And politics is the science of influence. That means they are influential. And if they are influential, if they decide they can create good values, but they decide not to because it does not benefit them. Thank you.
2009 and 2012, right? Or something like that. And personally, I was in Kapsabin. So I saw something that you mentioned that I was actually quite intrigued about it. The prefects, the one you were expelled from school because of going against how the prefects work. And funny enough, when I was back in high school, I had a used to call the prefects Karao, and I had a movement called Anti-Karao movement, like I was never expelled or suspended. What we used to do is, when you were in Masena and you were against how the leadership of the prefects were going against the people, what were your intentions? You wanted to change it to become like you wanted a whole system overall, to change the whole system, or how to enter inside to creep it from inside and change the whole system? That's just a question for you, not to like it's not among the questions. Just once you answer it as a by the question, and let me go to the one for the party. As I can see, you are on the road to form a party. I saw you ask people, and what I can say, it was actually impressive because you consult with people, and it's quite good because you know most of the ideas people have on this space are, I know many people now even have many questions, ideas, and will give them the mic after like 20 minutes more, and they will expound and ask you many questions, very quick questions. So I want to ask you something. I have seen that you want to form a political party, right? I can already see in the proposed naming of the party that we still don't have a coherent ideology behind it. And that is as far as I can tell. Concrete values have not been put forth, right? Let's say Inject is no different, at least as a name, from the plethora of seasonal names and parties we have seen in the country. We have parties that serve some function that is too narrow to occupy more than an election season. What, therefore, makes your party different? We know, like you said, you'll be accountable. Accountability in and of itself is not enough as an ideology, right? It's not like I could see the last time when we were doing the fancy, could say, trust me. No, we don't want to trust you. And I will come and talk about the system that we must put in place, what we were talking about. Let me ask you, accountability in and off itself is not enough as an ideology. Even Ruto's people, even Ruto's minions and his corrupt government are accountable to Ruto, right? They're accountable to Ruto, that we know, because if you tell them something, they will be accountable to their leader, who is Ruto. So one question, one needs to preach accountability in the service of something else. My question now is, what is this something else? What are these something else? Value system, in short, I'm trying to ask you, what is your political ideology?
Okay. My political ideology, number one, is economic emancipation. That is my first area of focus. I believe the economy that we've created is a bandit economy. It's an economy where politicians have more money than entrepreneurs and artists and sportsmen. And that means that's an unfunctional society. Because what do these politicians create here in Kenya except manufacture poverty? How should they have more money than people actually manufacture goods that we consume every day? The reason they have more money than manufacturers and entrepreneurs is because of theft. And my first focus in terms of what this party should be looking at ni kumaliza ufisadi kabisa. Because the only thing that this government does so well and that occupies their mind 90% of the time, it is theft, how they will steal public funds. And most of the problems that we have here in Kenya, there's a result of corruption. Because we have a teacher service commission that is not functional because of corruption. You have a cabinet secretary and an MP having TSC letters in a funeral. We have police who are completely inept and dysfunctional because of corruption. We have a broken down healthcare sector because of corruption. We invest money in it to buy equipment. The equipment is the money for the equipment is stolen. Sometimes we get equipment that is not functional, that is out of order. Sometimes drugs are taken and put in private chemists. So that has broken down our healthcare sector. We have an unfunctional education sector, one, because of incompetence, and secondly, because of corruption. People are only thinking about how they will make money. So nobody is thinking logically, how will we sort out this sector? What will we do about this education? What will we do about healthcare? What will we do about transport? What will we do about agriculture? They only think about theft. In fact, if they come up with a program, it's a program that will help them steal. The first motive is not how will we help the people of Kenya, you know, do better economically. It is just about theft. So my first political ideology is, can we please emancipate the people of Kenya economically? And can we end corruption and wastage of public funds? Because if we do that, we'll not need even to borrow a shilling from abroad. The money that we will have will be enough to run government completely. We have corruption even in workers of government, where we have ghost workers earning salaries, and the people who own those ghost workers are MPs, are senators. Unapata mbunge yako na ghost worker 100 ndani ya payroll. And that is why it has been very difficult to fight with ghost workers, because you are fighting with the people of influence. Apart from economic emancipation, there is also equitable distribution of resources and equal opportunities. Equal opportunities in the sense that in Kenya here, people are appointed or rather even employed on the basis of tribe. You go to the Kenya Pipeline Corporation and you will find almost 60% of all workers are from one tribe, and you're shocked how it actually happened. It is surprising how it happens. And you see, at the end of the day, much as these people are from one community there, the people who've put them there have not put them there because they care about that community. They are putting them there because they want to steal public funds. So you find, yes, you are innocently employed, but you don't know that there is a bigger game to it. Equitable distribution of resources in the sense that I have traveled all over Kenya, and I've been to 20 counties so far. I have seen how some regions are marginalized. You go to Mount Kenya, a place like Nyeri, much as they are complaining that some of their projects have stalled, of which they shouldn't stall because that's theft of public funds that has happened. But if you compare them with
a place like Siaya County. Siaya County, you go to a constituency like Ugunja, you only find one tarmac road. They got Nangabarubere Road, which has actually stalled. It's not even ongoing. And you cannot find any other tarmac. Zote ni Maraf Road. Failure. So you wonder, why is this region marginalized like this to the extent that it has no single tarmac road, but if you go to other constituencies, there is enough tarmac. There is actually no equal distribution of resources. And there is also the issue of opportunities for people to live, work, and grow. See, in Kenya here, instead of growing businesses, people are killing businesses. Businesses are dying from overtaxation. Businesses are dying from the exchange rate of the dollar. Businesses are dying from corruption. Businesses are dying from all manner of things, including lacking clients, because you can open a business, but the customers don't have the cash flow to buy because the government has squeezed all the money out of the hands of the people. We have a banking sector which does not benefit the people of Kenya, because if the bank has 200 billion this year, 170 billion, they have a big client called government that they are giving to. So they are only left with 30 billion for their 50 branches. So this big client called government, if you look deeper, you find that domestic borrowing is a Ponzi scheme, which banks are using to do business with government and make very huge interest. And for that reason, they don't need to do business with the general public. That's why you go to some banks and some branches, you don't even find people there. There's no one. Or you go in there and the branch is in a very sorry state. But if you look at the financials of the bank at the end of the year, there is growth, there is recording of bigger profits. So we have a kind of an economy that has been skewed in such a way that if you are not corrupt or a criminal, there are certain levels of success you cannot get to. So we need to change our economic structure, eradicate corruption, provide equal opportunities, and open up the space for people to invest. And we should not also have this thinking that investors are white. Ati tutaenda huko ngambo tutafute investor wazungu. No, some of the investors are even right here. In fact, I can speak about myself. I am an investor. If I'm empowered, I can... And that is how it should be for most of the investors here in Kenya. First, open opportunities for your people. Kabla ulete wazungu wakuje kuinvest. Can you first emancipate your people, those that you already have? Kenyans are very hardworking. Why should they go out there to build other countries when they can build this one? Reduce the cost of power. Remove unnecessary taxation. Remove this thing called the dependent power producers. Allow people to generate power at an affordable price. Open that market to be competitive. Okay, reform Kenya Power. If you can't reform it, wind it up and let individuals or private companies to provide power so that it is competitive and cheaper. These are things that the government does not want to do. And the reason they don't want to do it is it closes the gaps for stealing. Because everything they think about is stealing. Like recently, we had power blackouts in Kenya. And the first thing they said is, we have worn out equipment. What does that tell you? They want to procure. What is that? Theft. They've already thought of it. They'll make money. The Gen Z come out and demonstrate against bad governance, and someone sees an opportunity to steal public funds. They say, unajua wa Gen Z walitokea wakaharibu mabarabara, wakaharibu public infrastructure, we need to renovate. Then you allocate money for renovation. Then you steal public funds. There is just no conscience at all. Everybody who is in government, 90% of the time, they are only thinking about how to steal public funds. Even when they are traveling, they are thinking of how to travel. Wakati wanakimbia hapa kwa hizi mahighway na hizo mawiu sirens, they are actually opening the highways so that they can continue, they can run very quickly and steal public funds. So I need us to do economic transformation. I've taken a lot of time to talk about that point because that is my number one pillar. That's do everything that we can do to change the minds of Kenyans. Because one thing I've come to realize is that 90% of the Kenyans, they have never even read the Constitution. I don't know when you're on Twitter space, they've never, ever, ever read the Constitution. So you wonder, how are you going to know the system of governance that is good for you
If you've never read, wanasema hiyo tumewachia wanasiasa watusomee watuambie. Hiyo tumewachia mawakili. When in actual sense, every single Kenyan should have read the constitution. In fact, badala ya kupeana set books huko high school, the constitution should be a set book in high school that is a compulsory read for every student. That is why the president is able to go to villages, hold the microphone, and lie to Kenyans, and nobody would know he is lying because they've never read the constitution. They don't know what the type of governance they should expect. So we need that civic transformation. We need that civic change in terms of people thinking tribalism or thinking tribally. Because you come from a Kalenjin nation, but you find that, yes, the leaders are Kalenjin. For example, let me give you a live example. Yesterday at midnight, I was at Talanta Hela. Talanta Hela is a sports ministry in Upper Hill. There were players, Kenyan players, sleeping on the floor of the cabinet secretary, of the PS, because they've not been given tickets to go abroad and represent Kenya. And this is Team Kenya going to play in a world championship. Sasa wamelala kwa floor. When you look at the kind of leadership that we have in Kenya, the president is from that community. The cabinet secretary Murkomen is from that community. The PS engineer Peter Tum is from that community. So we have a lineup of three people from the same community, but the players who are also sleeping on the floor, some of them are from that community. So now you ask yourself, hii kitu ya mtu wetu inatusaidia nini? Because if the president is a Kikuyu and I'm a Kikuyu, then it should benefit me. But if it doesn't, then we need to awaken the conscience of the public. The other thing we need to awaken, and I've been able to do it successfully with the Vampire Diaries, is for Kenyans to know that they pay tax. Unajua, by the way, Kimuzi, you should know that 90% of Kenyans, they don't believe that they pay tax. That is why they are not pained by money stolen. Wakenya wengi, 90%, hawadhani ati wanalipa tax. Wamama huko villages, wazee, vijana huko kwa villages, they don't believe they pay tax. Wao wanaamini kwamba mimi nafanya kazi ya kupiga matofali, mimi nafanya kazi ya kupanda miwa, mimi nafanya kazi hii, mimi silipangi tax. They don't know that every day they go to the shop, when they buy a kilo of sugar, it is tax. When they buy 50 bob airtime, 10 bob or 15 bob is tax. When they buy mafuta ya kupika, they have paid tax. Kenyans need to know that they are paying tax. Kwa sababu wakijua kwamba wanalipa tax, watakuwa na uchungu sana pesa ikiibiwa. Lakini sasa wametuachia sisi kina Morara and other people ndio tupige kelele, kwa sababu wanaona ni kama sisi ndio tunalipa tax, plus wale wameandikwa kazi formally, plus hizi makampuni kubwa. Every Kenyan needs to know that if you've ever held even 50 bob to go to a shop to buy anything, on that day you paid tax. Ukipata wamama na wazee na vijana wameanza kufikiria kwamba they pay tax, then they will become wiser in terms of how they choose their leaders. The other thing is, most Kenyans are unable to connect with corruption. You know, I'm still on my second point here, civic transformation. Most Kenyans are unable to understand corruption. Wanashindwa kuelewa kabisa hii corruption inawaaffect nini. They watch television, wanasikia 6 billion stolen from Ministry of Health. This person has never held a billion. Hajai shika milioni. Hajai shika 1500. Sasa ukimwambia about 6 billion, they are unable to relate. They think you are talking to someone else when you are actually talking to them. We need to make corruption relatable. And that's what I'm saying with my Vampire Diaries. I was able to make corruption relatable to Kenyans. Because sasa mtu mwenye hakuanga na focus na ufisadi, ninaenda hadi kwao Nyandarua na muonyesha hiyo barabara iko nje ya kwake, hiyo ya Captain Dunyunjeru Kauruko kwa Geta, that road. Mtu mwenye hajaifikiria about corruption naenda huko CIA huko karibu Urenga, mahali inaitwa Kathieno, mahali kuna irrigation scheme ya mchele 480 million. Now it becomes personal, and that is a really good thing. Corruption needs to become personal for the people of Kenya. Then now, if we do civic transformation, we'll be able to get good leaders. Because then again, you need to remember that you can elect a good president and evil MPs, and the evil MPs will impeach the good president through propaganda. Watampiga piga hivi, wampige pige, waseme oh, you alifanya hivi, alifanya hivi. And you know, sometimes people never focus on the truth, they focus on the bad news. When a dog bites a man, it's not news, but when a man bites a dog, it's news. The other thing that we are looking at is environmental preservation. And apart from environmental preservation, we are also looking at minerals. In fact, in our party, we have a whole chapter that talks about minerals and natural resources. And this thing is a work in progress. I don't want to say that the party is fully formed or that our constitution is now perfect. No. Mimi kitu nimefanyia wa Kenya ni na watengenezea skeleton. Kazi ya kuweka nyama ni yenu. Me, I'm just building you a skeleton. Kazi ya kuweka nyama ni yenu. You are the ones to read the document. Once I upload it and put it out to the public, you are the ones to read it and say, hii iko sawa, hii haiko sawa, umesahau kitu fulani, weka. For example, on the issue of mineral resources, if you look at most progressive countries, they've created something that is called the Sovereign Wealth Fund. And what they do with the Sovereign Wealth Fund is 10% of all the taxes, plus all the money that comes from the natural resources. So all monies from natural resources, plus 10% of revenue collected, they put it in an account called the Sovereign Wealth Fund. And then now they start building a wealth fund, where it's not that you're receiving all the money, then spending it. You actually have hazina ya kitaifa, where you are keeping some wealth for generations. So those are some of the things you are thinking about. I'm not able to explain everything in this one space, because then again, I will talk without end. But at least you're getting the point of where my political ideology is heading, or rather where I'm looking and what my
perspective is. Yeah. I kind of get it. Yeah, because and one more thing, let me just combine, because I still have like three questions, then we open the platform for the people, because it's the most important question that I want to ask you. The way you have talked now, I have listened without interrupting, because I like listening so that I can ask you question. And you have reminded me one person that used to tell us in 2022 exactly, because I used to be the biggest supporter of William Ruto. I know that for a fact. I used to be the biggest supporter of William Ruto. But when he got the chance to be the president, he used to talk exactly about changing the system, ending corruption, all these. But what will make you different? Like, what change will you make so that it will make you different? And because I gave the other examples of people like Murkomen, who was in the youth agenda, the program which was in 2004. Then he was mentored maybe to become a good leader. We used to see him in the civil society, but we all know who Murkomen is now. I gave an example of John Kiarie, who used to act in ridiculous. Right now, John Kiarie has been swallowed by the system, the MP of Dagoretti South. We also have one person who I was really disappointed with, Oliver Karori Kipchumba, who almost defeated Mandago. I see people blaming people of Uasin Gishu, saying, well, vote Mandago, China Senator, and they don't know what happened in the party nominations. If Karori Kipchumba, because he won the party nominations, if he had stood his ground, maybe we wouldn't be having Mandago as a senator currently now. And the last person who are many people, the Gen Z, Gen Alpha, many people, and the older generation have seen a very peculiar transformation. At least two people, Muhammad Ali and Hussein Muhammad. Muhammad Ali, he used to give us these cases. He used to go to at length everything. But who is Muhammad Ali now? Most people don't know Jichupeg, who is now. Hussein Muhammad, the guy who you called the other day during JKL, is the complete opposite of what he used to envision himself as. So my question is, how will you prevent being swallowed by the system? What change will you make? And another question is, do you believe it's an individualistic characteristic or trait that is in a person that needs to change, or is it the system? Because it's the systems that we create. These monsters, these politicians, we are the people who create them, right? And it becomes hard for us to destroy them. Because I just want to ask you, even if we put now, let's say a random person, we just put somebody like Jose or something, I don't know, and he's a thief, and we have com- competent system, functioning system, like if there are people who are in diaspora, who are in abroad, you know what I'm talking about, functioning system. We don't care who is in charge. We don't care about the personality. That's why I'm coming to the word where you used to say, trust me, trust me. No, we want to trust the systems. We need the systems in check. We need to see how these systems will work for the common manage. We need to see how corruption will be defeated by the system, not by an individual. We cannot put all trust on an individual, right? We know this. We cannot put trust on a living being. Let's put trust on system. And what I was telling somebody, what we fail as a nation, what many people don't know, what is our biggest downfall currently now in Kenya, is how politicians move from being sweet talkers, they move from being the best people that we envision them, then they change when they enter the system. What does the system do? So the last question will be, we know the most robust democracies have extremely functioning system. The most robust democracies in the world. I would say the US is a robust democracy because they jail corrupt politicians. That's a fact. And the sign of the most functioning democracy is that which the politician literally disappears. So, what change, or how will you transform this, or how will you make this happen? How will you prevent yourself being swallowed by the system?
Thank you very much for that question. I'm really grateful that you asked me that. Asante kwa grill, thank you for asking, because this is a question that is very serious. Now, first, let me answer your question very quickly, then explain why I've answered it the way I've answered it. The answer is, I can't change anything. It is only Kenyans who can change it. Kenyans combined, not I alone. Kenyans combined. And I'd like to influence as many Kenyans to team up and change it. Let me just explain to you briefly politics as I understand it. As most of you already know, I don't lack political experience. Like, I'm not new to politicians. I know these people inside out. I know them because I've been in the shadows watching them and close to them, some of them. So for that reason, I really know very well what happens. And let me just explain it so that you understand the depth and the breadth of corruption and how bad it is, and how even if we elect Kimuzi today, there's nothing he can do. Guys, I want you to understand this. Recently, when I was speaking on television, I said I was offered an opportunity in government. I was not lying, I was saying the truth. And I said that I rejected it. And to a normal person listening to me, they don't get to believe that. Because most youth in Kenya are unemployed, disenfranchised, or even if you are employed, they are underpaid or overworked. If an opportunity was to come to any youth in Kenya to go and work in government, 95% of them will jump at that opportunity and say, yes, sir, very quickly. So what is this that made Morara reject such a thing unless he is lying to us? So I want to explain to you why I would never, ever, ever work inside this government in any position. Hata nipewe cabinet secretary, prime ka, siwezi taka. Corruption in Kenya begins from very deep. Let's say today William Ruto comes in front of that mahogany door and says, Morara Kebaso, you are here appointed cabinet secretary.
Allow me to interrupt you a little bit, Morara, because you are not audible, kindly.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yeah, now you're clear. Now you're clear.
Okay. So let's say William Ruto comes in front of that mahogany door at State House and says, Morara Kebaso, you are hereby appointed cabinet secretary for I don't know what. Do you know what will happen to me, guys, immediately? The first thing that will happen to me is people in my village will celebrate. Then I will need money to bribe MPs. Because once the president appoints, it's not a direct thing. The MPs who are going to be on the panel for vetting you, they need money. And if there are 14 of them and each of them wants 2 million, that's 28 million, that's 30 million. That is money that I don't have. So do you know what will happen next? There are cartels in that ministry. The ministry have been appointed as cabinet secretary. There are cartels in that ministry. Those cartels will approach me and they will say, ah, wabunge wanakusumbua, wanataka pesa. Don't worry, we'll take care of that for you. So a cartel atatoa pesa yake cash, atapea broker, atapelekea wale wabunge. When I go before that parliamentary committee, it will not be a vetting. It will be an exercise in futility. Nitakuwa tu nimekuja hapo kama flower girl. Watakuwa wananiuliza favorable questions which I already got a leakage. Alafu pia wengine wananitetea, wengine wananipiga kidogo for television, you know, for the drama. We've seen people who are grilled in parliament and it comes out that these people are actually unqualified. But still when the full list is given of people that have been approved for appointment, they are there. So you wonder then what was the purpose of the grilling? For example, Rashid Chesa, when he was being grilled, it could be seen that this is not a person that can occupy this kind of position. But they still approved him for appointment kwa sababu pesa imesha ongea. Now, once I go to that ministry and sit down, everybody will become a simp. PS will be simping. Directors of different departments will be simping. Chief accountant atakuwa simp. Kila mtu anakusifu, mtukufu, mkubwa, tajiri, mkubwa wetu. And the reason they are simping is because they want to understand you first. And these people are holding brief for some cartels. So what you find is that you are being undermined to the very smallest position. You are being undermined by the people that you work with because they have already put their interests ahead and you are not putting their interests ahead. Wanasema, hii ministry squeeze imeharibika. Wakati nani alikuwa hapa bana tulikuwa tunatengeneza pesa. Sasa hii mtu imekuja hapa, we are not getting anything. So you have your people fighting you. Now apart from pressure from the bottom, there is also pressure from the top. If it is Gashagwa who suggested you to be cabinet secretary, maybe from his share of government he was supposed to have 7 cabinet positions and therefore the one that fell vacant ni yake, so yeye ndiye amekusuggest. Gashagwa needs money. So broker wa Gashagwa will be at your door every Friday to give money. And I kwangi pesa kidogo, 200, 300, up to 500 million. Hii pesa ndio ipate, lazima uibe within that ministry. Na ukiiba, kama unahitaji kuiba 100 million, you'll not steal 100 million. You have to steal 300 million so that ubaki na 200 million. Moja ya kupea watu wako hapa kwa ground wa nyamaze, ubaki na ingine ya kujitetea in case a criminal case comes up, then 100 million upewe broker wa Gashagwa mpeleke. The same happens with ODM. This just doesn't happen in government. It happens even in opposition. Which are the worst performing and most corrupt counties? They are ODM counties. The ODM counties are the most corrupt and most dysfunctional. Why? Because the governor is working very hard to raise enough money to take to Raila. And even Wiper governor is working very hard to raise enough money to take to Kalonzo. Hii inakuanga kama ni ng'ombe wamefuga, wanangoja kukamua. So you find yourself holding a position of influence, but you have no real influence. Na kama we ni ODM governor, kosa kupeleka pesa kwa Raila uone. Next you will see MCAs impeaching you. Na unajua Raila akisema, ashasema, you are going home. So you utatafutiwa kama kosa hapa, you will be impeached, you will go home, and nobody will ever want to hear your second side of the story. Nobody want to hear that you are a person of integrity. Let's go to elections. Before you are elected in this country, what happens? If it is, say, a party like ODM, you need to buy the ticket. You need either to go to Karen and see Ida Odinga or go to Capitol Hill and see Raila and give money. And an ODM ticket for member of parliament can cost you up to 10 million. That's why a poor person cannot be an MP in that party because you don't have enough money to bribe. Unless uponyoke tu kibahati. So if you've already bribed for the party ticket, then this party leader has come and held your hand and said, hapa nataka mpigie Morara kama mbunge. Then you've won. Who do you owe your loyalty to? Is it the 50,000 voters that voted for you as member of parliament, or is it the party leader that gave you the ticket? You find that now you are loyal to the party leader than you are loyal to your citizens. Inamaanisha
party leader akisema, even if it is not in the interest of your citizens who elected you, unafuata hiyo direction. So it's a setup. Yani Kenya ni trap, ni setup, ni crime scene. Tayari corruption is so organized, it is a web, a very big web. Yenye every corner you turn, you find it. You turn this way, you find it. You go to the judiciary, you find it. Unaenda judiciary, unaenda kutafuta justice. Kumbe huko pia kuna wenyewe. The judge has brokers who broker cases for that judge. And these lawyers have connections even up to the Judicial Service Commission. Whenever a judge doesn't give them favorable orders, wanamuorganizia transfer, wanamtoa station, wanampeleka ingine. So you find getting justice even in that court is very difficult. Now, this same corruption, you come back this way, back to contractors. When you are a genuine businessman and you've been given a contract to supply or to build something for government, politicians are always on your neck asking for money. So whenever you are quoting a government project, if it was supposed to cost 150 million, you say 2.5 billion. So that you budget for the corruption money you will give to politicians. Sometimes you are put on pending bills and you have to spend money on a certain senator or a certain MP to use their influence and go there to the ministry and make noise so that you can be paid. When you are paid, they want a percentage. So unapata the government owes you money, but they are saying, yo, tukulipe, we need 20% out of this. So again, you find corruption doing mingia private sector. I've told you what banks in Kenya are doing. So banks are actively involved in corruption in Kenya, participating as financiers of corruption and benefiting from corruption proceeds. Private companies are benefiting from corruption. You go to institutions meant to fight corruption. You go to the Auditor General's office. The Auditor General, ile vitu mnaonanga kwa audit report ya Auditor General, only 10% of the corruption that happens in Kenya finds itself to the audit report. 90% of the corruption inaishia huko kwa ground, watu wanalipwa. EACC, there is corruption. DCI, there is corruption. In fact, even in the land fraud office, there is fraud. So then you ask yourself, you as a young Kimuzi or a young Morara, if you get into this government as an MP, what is it you're going to change? Truthfully speaking, if I, Morara, become an MP next week, there is no change I can make in this country, because I'll just be one out of 400 fools. If I get into cabinet today, there is nothing I can change in this country inside the cabinet, because I'm just one among 21 thieves. Remember, Ruto's qualification for you to be on the cabinet is how much you can steal, because he's accumulating wealth and he knows why he's accumulating that wealth. There is an empire he's building. The mission is collapse the country, make everybody poor, make everything cheap, come back with the money, buy all the airports, buy all the ports. Then 10 people sit in a room and they are 90% the wealth of Kenya. You don't need democracy. The 10 people just decide who is going to be president, and all the 49 million Kenyans, they become workers in their farm. So for this reason, he will only appoint people who know, who have experience of stealing. If you don't have experience, he doesn't want you. So now you find qualified people coming into government and they are unable to work. A brilliant person like Githu Muigai had to resign from this government because you are a legal advisor to government, but your legal advice is not needed. Because these people have already decided what they want to do. They have decided how they want to do it. So wewe kazi yako ni kufacilitate. So you find that your intelligence is not needed. Your expertise is not needed. You are only here to steal. So umetoka huko corporate world where you are CEO, people knew your competence. You are here in government. The only thing you need to do is steal and be incompetent and cover up and lie. If I become a governor, by the way, let me just tell you this. People have asked me, hey, Morara, sasa, si ungekuja kwanza Nyamira County tunyoroshe mambo. There is nothing you can change there. There is nothing you can change there because the first problem that is in the counties is that there is fake recurrent expenditure. You are a governor, you're receiving 14 billion per year. Out of this 14 billion, 70% is recurrent expenditure. And this 70% that is recurrent expenditure is going towards payment of salaries. These salaries 40% of your payroll are fake workers. Now, all these fake workers are not fake at they even know it. Unaweza pata dawa kimuzi, you are a fake worker in some county na ujui. They just collect IDs, sometimes from the online portal ya registration of, kama sasa wakati una register kama voters. They can go to that portal wa pick my ID. Then they put these people in the payroll as workers of the county. So unapata kama county kuna constituency tisa, kila mbunge ndio asipinge governor, ako na fake workers 50, mwingine ako na fake workers 20, each worker is earning about 40,000. So 40,000, if you have 20 fake workers, that is how much? That's around 8 million. So this person, apart from ile mshahara anapokea bunge, iko 8 million inamngoja kwa county ya fake workers wake wenye wako kwa payroll. The senator has, the former governor has.
So Morara,
if you start, wait a minute, just 1 minute. If you start cleaning up the payroll, Simba Arati tried it in Kisi. If you start cleaning up the payroll, you make an enemy. You become like Kawera Mwangaza. You make an enemy out of all the leaders in the county. Unapata ma MP wanakupiga, ma senator wanakupiga, ma MCA wanakupiga, and finally you'll get impeached, and you'll be getting impeached on public opinion, and nobody will ever know what will happen with you. So the truth is that there is nothing I can change if I occupy these small, small positions. The only thing I want the youth of Kenya to target, apart from targeting the youth, not just the youth, but all generations that are participating in this movement, target to fill parliament with people of integrity, target to fill senate with people of integrity, but most importantly of all, target to have a president who has integrity. That way, you can begin changing the system. But the system is currently constituted. Even if you choose one good person into that system, it doesn't matter if it is just one good senator, there is nothing they will change. So the truth is that there is nothing I can change unless I'm helped. Lazima nisaidiwe na wa Kenya. That's why civic education is important, to awaken Kenyans so that they see this thing the way I see it or the way other people are seeing it, so that we start awakening the conscience of Kenyans ndio to change this system, ndio tuweze kupati, kubring about the change we want.
So, thank you for that. And I have the last questions, then we'll open the platform for the people. And so you have realized that we need to focus on the systems and civic education more than political ambition of being a leader. That's what I've just told you. And like I said previously, you have reminded me of one William Ruto, 2022, because I was his ardent supporter. And until today, I've never been disappointed like that, because what he used to do, throw in figures, talk about a project, and go on to rant about the same question, because I was hell-bent on creating better systems. So let me just ask you a combination of four questions, then you take you answer it briefly, because we have many people with many burning questions in the DM, and we will give a randomly the mic. We'll choose randomly the mic. We will not choose the people you know. We'll choose a small wigs, anyone that can ask you questions. We need questions from people from the ground. Very quick questions. So let me just briefly. If you really consult with Kenyans, yeah, like you said, why didn't you consult them on the US trip that you are supposed to go for 3 weeks? You know it. Where do you get the funds? Because it's not only from Kenyans, that I know. I remember in JKM we said it's only from Kenya. Where do you really get the funds? Because I know you have if for accountability you can post all your M-Pesa statement, the kind of money Kenyans send, like I did. I did send in June 26th, for all accountability, you can just post the M-Pesa and just feature to Gina, no problem. Another question. Do you think revolution is the only way to uproot the old system, this rotten system of corruption? And the last question, tax accountability. How do you intend to go about it? Because we know in Kenya the problem is not taxes, because even the population that is taxed in Kenya is less than 10% or less than 15%. That's a fact. I'm not talking about VAT and other things. The real people who are taxed are less than 15%. So how do you intend to go about this? And the last question is about yesterday. What brought about yesterday your squabble and beef with the Masitaru Island there?
Thank you so much. I'll begin with the Mercy Tarus one.
All right, let me start again. I'll begin with the question on Mercy Tarus. First, I respect her contribution to the movement and what she's been able to do. And I also acknowledge the mistakes that she's been able to make. She's human. She will make her own mistakes and learn from them if she's wise enough to learn from them. I was disappointed that I actually trusted her and even texted her to who are here, who have inboxed, including KOT Sonko and many other people who I usually speak with you on the park side, on the side bench, to just try to get your mind, because I don't believe I'm the fountain of wisdom. So I was disappointed to see that she would digress to the level of actually posting our private conversation. But this is it. Mercy Tarus has something she says, Kenya ni home. And she says that this Kenyan home is actually a private or personal trademark that she uses. My thinking is that, first, of course, there is evidence that has come out that Kenyan home has been used before. There's even a lady called Kanini who used it back in 2013. So therefore, she's not the first to use it. But I would wonder whether I'm the one who has the mistake or her, because I used Kenya ni home because kwani Kenya ni wapi? See, Kenya ni nyumbani. Kenya ni home. Kenya ni nyumbani. This is a phrase that should be owned by 50 million Kenyans. In fact, I expect every Kenyan to print the words Kenya ni home and put them on their walls. So how do you take a national phrase, then personalize it and own it and make it look like a private company? You know, it's like saying you want to register a trademark for Hakuna Matata, and nobody else should use the word Hakuna Matata because you've registered it. There are things you can't own. So I was just trying to not understand. I've been unable to understand. I saw, some media, people like Tuko write that Mercy Tarus and Morara fight. Mercy Tarus and Morara did not fight. It is Mercy Tarus that fought Morara and Morara never responded. The whole day I ignored, I kept doing my own things, informing the public what I'm doing with their money, what I've done with the furniture, what I've done this and that. So Mimi, I didn't fight her back and I didn't respond. And even now, I still don't feel like it is something worth responding. Kenya ni home is a national phrase. Many Kenyans are going to use it. She cannot own it. She cannot personalize it. It's not her property. You cannot say, for example, Haki iwe ngao na mlinzi, useme haki iwe ngao na mlinzi is now your personal property, you've trademarked it. You can't even trademark that. It's a national phrase. It's part of the words of the national anthem. So hiyo ilikuwa kazi ya upuzi. And she also said that I've never been arrested. I've been arrested more than Mercy Tarus. In fact, I've stayed in the prison cell for 10 days and I've stayed in a real prison for 47 days. She said, I've never been seen in action. I was not there during the protest. That's a flat lie. I was there during the protest. And by the way, I came with my wife. Unajua ukiona mwanaume amekuja na bibi yake kwa protest, it means I'm providing good leadership at home. Inamaanisha nimerally my family behind me. You know, so some of those things, they were multiplication of zero raised to power infinity. It was total nonsense sold at a cheap price. I don't think it's something I should respond to. Ni kitu ili nikasirisha, I was not happy about it, but kitu nimekuja kulan kwa hizi streets za Twitter is that the bigger your profile, the more you will be fought. So nikianza kujam sahi, nita jam kila siku for the rest of my days. Ndakua nimejam, kila siku ndakua nimefume. Oh, leo Ekuru Okota ameniandika. Oh, sijui leo Kimuzi ameandika. Oh, sijui leo nani ameandika. You know, let me tell you, mti mkubwa upigwa mawe. Lazima, iyo lazima ni expect. People are going to throw stones. I just need to look at a father, to look like a father, and also embrace everyone, including those who will fight me, and try to get their point. Because, you know, sometimes people fight you and they have a point. Sometimes they are actually struggling to be heard because the room is crowded, there's too much noise, and they want their voice to be heard. So I don't think that I'll shove it down on her. And I'm even willing to work with her in the future. But yeah, same, I'm
join our party and work with us, me, I'm ready to work with them.
What are your vote, Ms. Pilo? We can check.
Again, can I have my audible now?
Yes, you are.
So ndio nasema if Mercy Tarus wants to work with me in the future, me sina shida. I'm ready to work with her. I'm ready to work with everyone. And I don't know the motive, although I know a lot about what they are up to and the NGOs that are involved and the funding. But you see, those are rumors without evidence. So I don't want to say too much about it, yet I'll be challenged to produce evidence. What I can say is that I'm ready to work with them if they are ready to join me, or if they are ready to onboard me on something that is functional and sensible. Aya, let's go to question number two. Where I get my funding? Good question, by the way. I will say it again, and I'm not lying. I get my funding from the Kenyan people. Apart from the Kenyan people, pia mimi niko na kazi nafanya. By the way, before this thing started, I had a job. I had things I was doing. I had businesses. I have investment. Niko na tu vitu hapa na pale. Ni vile sasa nikianza kuzitaja sana, it then starts looking like I'm trying to, it looks like a show off party. I don't want this to be a show off party, but ukweli ni kwamba Mungu amenibariki at a young age, and I've been hard working si kwanza leo. Anybody who wants to know my story, let them go to YouTube, watch my interview with Lynn Ngugi, which was a 2-hour interview. You will know where I was born, how I grew up, when I started working hard, how much money I made, what I did. Na nimefanya biashara mingi, nimefanya biashara ya maziwa, nimefanya biashara ya kuunda yogurt, nimefanya biashara ya kuuza avocado, nimekuwa na hoteli Kawangware 56, nimekuwa na Wines and Spirit, nikaokoka, nikafunga, I've done online writing, vitu nimefanya hii dunia, there are so many, nimejaribu kuuza insurance, nikashindwa, nimejaribu kuuza mashamba, nikashindwa, maana nimepiga struggle, nimepiga hustle, nobody should blame me for being rich at a young age. Hakuna mtu anafaa kuniambia. People should just say, hey, banze, umeninspire, nataka kujua how you run your business, pia mini learn. Because I lead 85 people, maze. At 28 years old, to be able to employ 85 people, you sio kitu kidogo. Now, of course, the company makes millions in a month. So, si ati nimekosa sana a way of earning a living. Ni vile, politics or rather civic education is expensive. Nikianza kutumia pesa yangu, itaisha within 1 week na nitakuja tuanze kubeg pamoja. But hiyo 100 bob, 50 bob, 500 bob, 1000 yenye mnanitumianga, it helps sustain me. Na so far, nime raise pesa from Kenya. Kuna ile time niliraise, nikanunua ile gari mliona. Hiyo gari tukakuja tukaraise pesa ya sound, mliona niliweka hiyo sound. Later tukakuja, what did we raise money for? Tumekuwa tukiraise money for fuel, na kweli mumeniona nikizunguka all over the country. Mnanionanga sometimes nikizunguka na convoy ya watu. What you should know is that hiyo convoy ya hizo magari mnaonanga kwa convoy, like the Range Rover you saw, those people si ati ni mimi nimewafuelia gari. Si ati pesa yenu yenye mmetuma sasa nimeanza kufuelia watu wa gari wanizindikize. No. Those are willing people wenye unijoin. Sasa kama kesho naenda Mount Kenya tour, people come and join me and fuel their own cars, na hadi wanajilipia accommodation. Imagine mana. We should not belittle their investment or rather their commitment. For example, siku ingine niliona wakisema sijui ile BMW ni ya Gashagwa, hiyo BMW ya black. That BMW belongs to my lawyer Solonka Pareno, and Solonka Pareno is 27 years, no, he's born 1997 means he's 26 or 27 hapo. He's my lawyer. His office is in Ngong Road, pale Kindaruma Road. Mkitaka kuenda, mnaweza enda mconfirm. And he's a man who has become successful at a young age. Na hajakuwa successful at because ako entitled or because alipata things on a silver spoon. Of course, amesupportiwa by family and other people. Lakini ukijana amework hard. You guys should know that guy won an award of best law student in Kenya School of Law during his year. He's one of the best lawyers that are there. In fact, huyo ni mtu ameenda hadi Mandela Fellowship Leadership, Mandela Leadership Program in the US. He's a brilliant guy. So pia ame struggle, ame manage, ame nunua ofisi, ame nunua gari yake, then people are all over the place saying, oh, hii ni ya Gashagwa. Hizo propaganda hakuna. About the US trip, I don't know what the US trip is about. First, I don't have a US visa.
I have never gone to the US myself, and there's no US trip I had planned for 3 weeks. There was a conversation that was ongoing about me going to the US to go and speak with the diaspora, and also to go and attend Ikitu ya World Bank yenye inafanyika this coming month. That conversation was there, and even the diaspora people ndo walikuwa na invite. But as it stands now, there's no trip yenye nilikuwa ati nishapanga hadi nimenunua ticket ama nilikuwa na pesa ya kwenda. Hapana, this was a conversation that was ongoing. It was a consult, it was an idea that we were mooting about going there. Kwa hiyo mambo ya World Bank, kwanza tujue mbona wana fund projects in Kenya na wafuatili, why are they financing corruption, what is their interest, what is their interest in Kenya, and why are they supporting corruption for sure. And I also wanted to go to the US niende ni meet watu ya diaspora, nianze ku build networks zangu, not just for now but even for the future. So hiyo mi kwenda US sioni kama there is any mistake I did there. Na hiyo opportunity kitokea, nitaenda. I want to assure you, nitaenda. Whether nitachangiwa na Wakenya kupata ticket kuenda, whether nitatoa pesa yangu nijilipie niende, ama watu wa diaspora watanilipia, one way or another, I will go. So my source of funding is Kenyans, na sometimes me will top up na pesa yangu, and that is how I manage. Even for me to manage, kuna vile mi usupportiwa hivi within my family na pata kakitu. So it's not like I have some source of funding that is unknown. People used to say it's Gashagwa. Mi mwenyewe nimesema Gashagwa does not represent the kind of leadership that we want in a country. I've personally said it many times. Na nikasema we cannot jump from the frying pan to the fire. So ni lini hiyo Gashagwa ameanza kunifinance? Jimmy Wanjigi cannot finance me because Jimmy Wanjigi himself is running for president. Sasa ananifinance nifanye nini? Ama ni lete change gani? And if he was financing me, then I should be in Safina Party, which is his political party. Why am I out here trying to struggle to register a new political party? Yeah, so mambo ya funding na kupewa na watu wengine, hakuna funding nimepokea kutoka kwa watu wengine. There's nothing like that. Ile nyumba yenye mliona, that mansion, that house is I think it's a 9-bedroom house. Na hiyo nyumba, I was looking for a house, na hadi niliadvertise hapa kwa X, hadi kwa Facebook, nikasema natafuta place inaweza kuwa ofisi. I received many suggestions, watu wa wengine walikuwa wananitumia nyumba ziko Karen, nikamwambia Karen itapeana, it will be too far for people to access. Wengine wananitumia nyumba za Lavington, Lavington there's too much traffic going there, even for me getting to that office. And secondly, the houses in Lavington were too expensive. And then there was also people sent me houses even in Eastlands. And nikamwambia the kind of places they were suggesting in Eastlands, that's a very insecure place. Hakuna vile unaweza weka hata equipment ya computer hiyo place hapo ndani, it will be broken into na ziibwe. So then somebody came who is a family friend, is known to my family, not even just that in my family, me and my family, like my parents and my uncles. This is a family friend who looked for me through my family, nika connectiwa, akaniambia kijana, niko na nyumba najenga Kawaskari, na juu siishi kwa hiyo nyumba, and it was just supposed to be a holiday home, na pia nilikuwa najenga because your plot imekuwa idle for long. Take that house and make it your office. The only thing I want you to pay is this amount monthly so that it can cater for caretaker, watchman, na water flowers, na bills, hapa na pale, nini, maintenance of the property isiishe. Na nika accept. Nika sema since this is somebody who is known to me, is not a stranger, I'll take the house. Na kama nikona any fear kwamba the government will come plant any listening devices or trackers before I occupy the house, I'll do a security sweep. Say, okay, we've seen where our membership fees goes, we've seen where our donation goes. That is why nataka kujenga structure, ndio nijiondoe kwa hiyo story ya do, ni entrust a team of professionals, wafanye resource mobilization, wafanye allocation of money, expenditure, mimi nipeane tu leadership and oversight. So those are my answers to your few questions.
Now we're going to move to other people now, other speakers. I shake. We can start with you.
Mudoni, before I just land, I just asked the last question. Do you think a revolution is the only change you can effect? You can answer maybe another time, no problem.
I can even answer it now. Kenya needs a revolution, but wacha niwaambie ukweli. Ile kitu yenye mlifanya 25th June, msidanganyike kwamba inaweza fanyika this week ama next month. The government learned your game, and by the way, until 25th June walikuwa wanatu underrate. They never thought it is that serious, but when we occupied parliament, these people woke up and they realized this thing is serious. Now you should also know that Ruto does not work in isolation. Ruto is assisted by CIA. The US is a very integral part of keeping Ruto in power. The CIA gives him information. Easy apps, zote mnatumia X, Facebook, nini, nini. Those apps are American companies. And I will be cheating myself to say that CIA are not in those companies. In fact, in some cases, unaweza pata labda kuna app like Facebook or another app, yenye gava iko na back-end access. These people, this time round, they will never, ever, ever accept something like that to happen anytime soon. But we can do it. The question is how? We can have a repeat of 25th June, now not in parliament, but in state house. We can have it. The question is how? And I'll tell you how. Ile 25th June was an epic moment. The reason we managed to do that thing is because all of us were on board. Ata Gen Z was not even about poor people. Rich people were coming, wanapack Range Rover zao pale, wanaingia kwa protest, wana donate maji, wanajipaka Colgate, wanaanza kuparticipate. I was there, my wife was there. Yet niko na biashara huko yenye naweza enda ni run. But I was there in the protest. So it was not a class issue. It is for once Kenyans came together, all of them, to fight for one thing. Now what happened? Fear. The government understood the game of fear. The reason they were abducting people in public was because it was supposed to spread fear. They didn't want to do it in private because then it doesn't achieve the mission. The reason they were killing people and throwing them in quarries is fear. The reason we had discovery of bodies dismembered is fear. They were sending chills down your spine so that when you think of that dead person with brains all over the floor or all over the road, you think about yourself. And you ask yourself, is it worth dying for? And I can tell you, 90% of Kenyans are scared about dying. And Niccolo Machiavelli, in the Prince, says that it is better to be feared than loved. He talks about, you know, narcissistic politicians. And he talks about them being feared is better than them being loved. And that is one thing they understood. They understood that if they shoot people blank on the streets, you guys will fear. And that is what has happened. Si leo mliitisha maandamano. Ni watu wangapi wametokea kwa hiyo maandamano town? There was Occupy maandamano today. But it did not happen. Why didn't it happen? Because people have been pacified. People have also experienced emotional fatigue. Unajua saa nyingine mnapitianga shida. Paka hiyo shida inakuchosha. Hiyo shida ikikuchosha, now you become, you know, you just become a person that is pacified. Now you feel like you don't have the energy to fight anymore. So most Kenyans wako kwa hiyo stage yenye hawana energy to fight anymore. If I was to advise the rest of you in terms of how we can beat this government, the reason we lost Nane Nane is because 70% of the country did not support us. And that is the village and informal settlements. Watu wenye wako kwa village hawaku tusupport kwa maandamano vile inafaa. Kama walitokea ni wachache sana. Let me tell you, if you want to bring this country to its knees, 70% of this country lives in the villages, not in the towns. You need to make those people buy your idea. Kwa hivyo inafaa kwanza X, kwanza tukwange tunakuja on a necessity basis. Tuondoke online. Online tukue tunakuja kushow what we've been doing on the ground. Tuvae gumboots. Wa mama wajifunge leso. Tuingie kwa ground. We talk to the public. Not fight them. Not argue with them. Not tell them how foolish they are. No. We talk to them. We buy them. We win them over with love and explain to them why they should care about Kenya. Because most of the villagers don't care, as I said earlier. Our watu wenye wako kwa villages who are 70% of the country, who Ruto goes to whenever we attack him. So whenever tunampuwekea pressure hapa kwa city, he goes to the village to hold a rally. Hao watu ndio inafaa tuongeleshe, hao watu wakue on one page with us. Hao watu wa village wakimanage kuwa one page with us. I can tell you a revolution will happen in Kenya. Utakuwa unaona tu polisi wanatoa uniform, wanaweka chini, wanajoin demonstrators. It will be Bangladesh. But until we do that, it will not be Bangladesh because we are too few and people see us as elites. Unajua tunaonekana kama ma elite, sisi watu wa X. People see us as the educated upper middle class of society. So tunakaa ni kama hatu resonate with the rest of the country. So watu wa watu feel. Lazima tuingie ground, wajua kwanza sisi ni watoto wao. Hii kizungu tunaongea, kama sio wao walitupeleka shule, hatungekuwa tunaongea. Tu interact na hawa, say to bond na wao, waelewe ni nini tunapigania. Once wameelewa ni nini tunapigania, we need to get into those vernacular radio stations and vernacular TVs. So yes, Kimuzi, let me now answer your question. A revolution can happen in Kenya, but it is not yet time. Wacheni kutoa githeri kwa jiko yenye haijaiva. Tupike hii kwanza kitu iive, ndio tuifanye. That is my sentiment about it. We can only remove Ruto through two ways, the ballot or the bullet. The bullet is very difficult. It needs national consensus. The ballot is possible. But you can see, Ruto tayari ashajipanga for 2027. Wakati nyinyi mnasema it is too early to form a political party, Ruto is already playing his games at IEBC. Tayari mnaona vile anacheza na hiyo IEBC. Meaning ashapanga 2027, ashaanza games saa hii. Na nyinyi mnataka tungoje paka ile time. And you should also differentiate between a political party by the Gen Z and a political party by William Ruto. You should remember William Ruto has stolen enough, he's a trillionaire. Akiamua kuunda a political party 3 months to election, it will be a very popular political party because he has the money. He will hire all the consulting firms, he will hire all the professionals, he will hire Cambridge Analytica, he will hire all propaganda machineries, and in 1 week, you will have a very big political party with all strong candidates. Sisi, we are building this thing from scratch. We don't have those kind of resources and neither do we have a personality cult following us. Lazima tuanze mapema. So don't be told that it is late. We must begin early, set our structures, tupigane. We need to fight. We need to fight within the party. Ili tupigane, tuelewane, to settle. Once we settle, we start building our financial war chest and start identifying candidates of people of integrity, because you cannot remove William Ruto and not replace him with someone. Nandiyo mana, even the time when this Gen Z was happening, I was asking people, guys, what is the plan? Munasema Ruto must go. Are we ready for Gashagwa? If we are removing all these people, the same way Raila alikuja akateka advantage of the Gen Z protest akajibenefit, is the same way a military leader will have taken advantage of us removing William Ruto and take power and lead Kenya. And he would become more corrupt than William Ruto. So we must have a plan. If we are removing William Ruto, who are we replacing him with? If we are removing Sakaja, who is the replacement? Is that person a person of integrity? Sasa vile mnanivet sahi, inafaa mwanzo kuvet au.
Thank you.